Hey everybody, my name's Zach, and today I want to talk about how to run the Call of Cthulhu scenario, the Sanatorium. I found this scenario in the book Mansions of Madness, and it appears to be a 6th edition scenario, but it's very easy to convert to 7th edition. So in this scenario, the player characters are invited to an exclusive sanatorium on an island run by a controversial research psychologist named Dr. Aldous Brewer. Once the players arrive at the island, however, they quickly discover that something is amiss at the facility and that they might be on their own in order to survive their stay. The sanatorium is a medium-sized survival sandbox, and I've run it twice, and with both groups it took me about 2 3-4 hour sessions to complete. It does require a decent amount of work on behalf of the keeper in order to prep it properly, but it's definitely worth it given the premise. So in this video, I'm going to uncover the mystery of exactly what happened leading up to the character's arrival at the island. I'm going to go through each section of the scenario and give you tips on how to run them. And then at the very end, I'm going to give you a 1-minute plan that you can follow to run the scenario successfully. So let's get started. One quick disclaimer first, this video is for keepers only. I'm going to be spoiling the whole scenario, so if you're a player, you should stop here. Call of Cthulhu is a mystery game, so if you spoil everything for yourself in advance, you're not going to have any fun. Alright keepers, now that it's just us, let's dive in. So first, let's start by deconstructing the mystery of what actually happened before the players entered the scene. So Dr. Aldous Brewer is a controversial research psychologist who is experimenting with various personalities of his multiple personality disorder patients. He claims that through his patients, he can actually communicate with personalities of long dead real people from history. And actually, as it turns out, he's right. He was able to contact an ancient Egyptian priestess who actually fought off an invasion of Cthulhu mythos monsters in ancient Egypt, and she terms these those who wait. But unfortunately for Dr. Brewer, he also was able to contact someone else from history through a different patient, one of those who wait themselves. The monster took over the mind of the patient and forced him to draw a gate through which those who wait was able to appear in the reality of the sanatorium. So when the monster came through, it cast aside the patient and instead took control of a powerful orderly working at the hospital. It consumed a few victims at the sanatorium, and then it headed off to the north side of the island to hide in a derelict lighthouse there. Its goal is to consume enough humans to eventually metamorphosize into a much larger and more dangerous Cthulhu mythos monster. The process of the metamorphosis is so violent that when it does end up happening, it's going to kill everyone on the island. To keep itself safe, the monster is hidden in the lighthouse and it's sending the orderly out instead to find and ritually sacrifice people in a way that can remotely feed the monster from a distance. So the players arrive a few hours after the orderly has just sacrificed Dr. Brewer for this exact same purpose. Once they get off the boat and they head up to the sanatorium, they find that the patients are all loose and the staff has all been violently murdered. The orderly is at this very time down at the dock murdering Ebenezer the boat captain and cutting off the investigator's ability to get off of the island. So the player characters have no choice but to investigate the sanatorium and interview the dangerous inmates to find out what happened. Uncovering the mystery is the only way to thwart those who wait before it consumes enough victims to metamorphosize and basically destroy everyone on the island in the process. So let's take a second to talk about setting and character creation. Before I say anything else, let's just acknowledge the obvious movie parallel. I know everyone is already thinking it.
Give you a briefing about the institution?
All I know is it's a mental hospital.
For the criminally insane.
You'll never leave this island.
Yep, that's right. This scenario is Shutter Island, Cthulhu style. I mean, for God's sake, you even start on a boat. Honestly, my advice is just to embrace it. Go for the full Shutter Island feel. You could even go so far as to set this in the 1950s if you really want, although I think the 20s setting works fine. The only thing you really need from your setting in order to run this successfully is to be in a time when psychotherapy was a new science still, and they still did kind of questionable stuff. As far as character hooks are concerned, I think you can go in a few different directions here. Obviously, again, if you want to go with the Shutter Island feel, I think a group of US federal marshals who are coming to the island to make sure everything is above board is a great hook. They're going to be very well equipped to deal with the scenario. The other obvious choice is for the players to play doctors themselves. They could either be fans or rivals of Dr. Brewer, and high psychotherapy and medical skills actually are going to be really useful in this scenario. Finally, having a connection to a patient who's on the island is a great premise as well. I've run the scenario twice, and actually one of my groups decided to play a group of rich housewives who knew the NPC Blanche. They knew that she had been arrested and sent to a sanatorium a few years ago, and so they were heading to the sanatorium in order to get some dirt and juicy gossip about her condition that they could bring back to their social circle. The introductory section of the scenario is comprised of two main role-playing scenes for the players. Firstly, riding the boat to the island, and then secondly, approaching the sanatorium up on the cliffs and finding out that something is wrong. This section is really all about setting the tone and establishing the sandbox that the players are going to be playing in. I like to do it as a bit of a hot start where the PCs are already in the middle of the action. So they're on the boat already. I describe the choppy waves, the grating sound of the boat engine, and the smell of diesel. And I ask who has the lowest starting luck. Whoever's is lowest starts the scenario with a scene of their character seasick and puking over the side of the boat. I also like to give the players Dr. Brewer's article for free in this scene as well, just because, you know, you want them to uncover the mystery. So what I do is whoever has the highest EDU skill, I say, has looked it up prior to them getting on the boat, and I actually start the scene with their character reading this article out loud to the other PCs. Once they finish, I'll let the PCs get comfortable in their characters by letting them roleplay and talk about the contents of the article in character. Obviously, you know, whenever you're running new PCs, it's going to be a first awkward conversation, and so inevitably it will die down, and when it does so, that's when I like to bring in Ebenezer, the boat captain, who can come in and check in on the PCs. I play Ebenezer as very friendly and also very favorable towards Dr. Brewer. I use him to set a time bounds for the PC's visit. He'll say something like, "So, I understand you'll be staying with us for 5 days," and that way once the PCs are in hot water, they have an answer to the question, when is somebody going to know this that we're missing and try to come rescue us? Ebenezer will also remark that the weather's looking pretty bad for the next few days, and I like to have him sort of nervously touch his hand to his upper chest area just to indicate the presence of the Elder Sign necklace that he wears. I know the module says that players shouldn't notice it in this scene, but I don't see any reason why they shouldn't be able to see it with a successful spot hidden roll. If they do notice it and they ask him about what it means, he can just tell some tall, you know, ship's captain tale about his time sailing in the South Pacific, and maybe he can make an allusion to Deep Ones or something, just as a kind of a red herring and a fun tie-in to the larger mythos. Once the PCs make it to the island, I give a classic spooky description of the imposing building up on the cliffs, and Ebenezer prompts the PCs to head up alone while he ties up the boat. To plant in their minds that it's strange when he ends up not showing up later on, I also like to have Ebenezer offer to pick up their luggage and carry it up for them, just so that the PCs can make the connection of, hey, we never got our luggage, oh wait, Ebenezer was supposed to bring that to us, what happened to him? Once the PCs get to the front door, this is where you can finally spring the conditions of the scenario on them. So Blanche, an obvious patient, wearing a gown, opens the door, and then Leonard attacks the PCs. The way that I run this combat is it's basically fake. So the first time a PC makes any hostile motion towards him, even if they're unsuccessful, I just describe how he falls into a puddle on the floor, sobbing and sad that somebody tried to hurt him. And the reason I do this is because the point isn't really necessarily to have a deadly combat here. It's more just to firmly demonstrate that the inmates are loose and they're dangerous, and the PCs need to be careful when they're in the sanatorium. From there, they'll enter the sanatorium itself and discover that the staff has been murdered and that they're on their own. After your players confront Leonard at the front door and are invited inside by Blanche, the main investigation section of the module begins. So the players will need to explore the building and the grounds to understand why the staff has been murdered and why the patients are loose. Overall, there's three main clues that you want to make sure your players get in this section before they move on to the final confrontation with those who wait. Firstly, you want them to know that a monster was unleashed through the gate in Alan Harding's cell. Secondly, you want them to know that an orderly from the sanatorium is performing ritual sacrifices that are likely connected to the monster in some way. And then third and finally, you want to give them the clue that the monster's origin is connected to the ancient Egyptian story in the Castro manuscript, and as well as to Darlene's priestess Anephis personality optionally. The sandbox for the investigation is very large and open-ended, so it's kind of hard for me to give you like a do A, do B, do C, and then your players will have fun type of explanation, because it's pretty much completely up to the players how they want to handle the various elements. Some groups might be terrified by the inmates and shoot first, ask questions later. Others might feel a lot of empathy for them and want to take care of them and interview them all individually. Similarly, some groups may see the sacrificial lights on the first night and just rush out into the island to see what's going on. Others may be terrified and try to hole up in the sanatorium and wait out their 5-day stay on the island. So I know that's not very useful as prep advice, so what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to talk you through what I consider to be the essential role-playing scenes that should occur probably before your players finally do go off to confront those who wait. So first, let's talk about discovering Ebenezer's murder. This is a short scene, but a pretty important one. At some point in the sandbox, the players are going to realize where the heck is Ebenezer, and they're going to ask themselves the question, can we just get back on the boat and get off the island? So this scene is short, but it's important. There's two clues that I like to give here. First, that the murder was done with an axe. That kind of sets the connection between the orderly who's sacrificing people and the murder of Ebenezer. And then secondly, of course, is the actual Elder Sign necklace itself. I let players find this as long as they do a normal spot hidden roll. The next scene I want to talk about is obviously finding sacrificed Dr. Brewer in his office. So when the players do this, I really love to ham up the goriness of the description. Of course, you know, you want to read your table and make sure that you understand what they like first before you do that. But the reason why I like to do it this way is because, you know, this is the sanity loss for seeing Dr. Brewer's corpse is actually 1/1d6. So what that means is that this is likely the first chance in the scenario that one of the players has the possibility of running into a bout of madness. Once that's established, I think the most important thing to point out with this scene is that this is pretty much where like 80% of the handouts for the entire module get given to the players all at once. So you want to make sure that you set this appropriately within the timetable of your gaming session that night so that the players have enough time to really read everything over and sort of have a nice in-character and out-of-character description about what they've learned. The next scene I want to talk about is discovering the gate in Alan Harding's cell and speaking with the mad poet himself. So this is a really important clue. So what I like to do is just make the trail of the monster down at the basement really obvious that they follow it appropriately and run into this clue. Also, Alan Harding is a mad poet, so I like to prepare a poem. The one that I use is called Antigonish by William Hughes Mearns. I think it fits with the scenario really well because it sort of, you know, refers to the presence of those who wait within Alan Harding's mind. And it's also a poem that a lot of players have actually heard before because it's pretty famous, but they're usually not able to attribute it to the actual author, so it's pretty easy to make the connection that Alan Harding himself wrote the poem. Yesterday upon the stair, they met a man who wasn't there. He wasn't there again today. Wow, I wish he'd go away. It's a fun one and pretty creepy. Midway through the interview, I like to have those who wait take over Alan and actually speak to the players directly. Those who wait kind of give some menacing statements about how he's going to consume them all. And then I like to do sort of like a Hellraiser style death for Alan Harding once those who wait has finished threatening the players. You know, like it's even fun if you want to make them have a dex check to see if they get splattered with the gore. Another scene that I think is important to cover is having a confrontation with Charles Johnson, the orderly himself. Notice that I'm saying confrontation, not fight to the death. I don't think it's necessarily important that your players kill Charles Johnson. It's more just that they actually see what he's doing in person so that they can make the connection to the murders and that they are all being perpetuated by this orderly. When you're running the encounters with Charles Johnson, I think basically he gives you two cards that you can play as a GM. The first one is hearing a sacrifice over at the sacrificial rock. This usually happens on the first night of the scenario. And then the second one is the orderly himself and the players actually seeing him commit the violence. So what I like to do is play these cards whenever there's kind of a lull in the action of the scenario. You know, like whether or not the players maybe have just uncovered another important clue and there's kind of like a quiet lull where the PCs like are not really sure what to do next. I like to drive the action forward by presenting one of these things. The last role-playing encounter that I think is worth discussing is contacting Priestess Anephis through the Darlene NPC. So I would say of all the ones that I've discussed, I don't think this one is necessarily required, but I do think if you can work it in, it's really fun and worthwhile to do. What I like to do is give Darlene 2 to 3 personalities to actually cycle through before she arrives at the Priestess Anephis personality. And that way, you know, it feels like a more, you know, long form transformation, and it really sucks in the players as they're kind of doing their psychotherapy. Beyond that, if the players get this far and actually do realize that they can contact the Priestess and they're successful at it, I like to give them a lot of clues here. I like to have the Priestess be very open and honest about what it is that's actually going on and what the weaknesses of the monster are. And I like to give my players a chance to actually learn the spell. Darlene might draw the Elder Sign on one of their hands, and I kind of describe it as like a henna tattoo that never fully fades away. And you know, if you do like an epilogue for this particular scenario, or if you reuse the characters, I like to say that from then on until the end of their life, that PC has kind of this very faint Elder Sign drawn into their hand. So a final disclaimer before we move on, I'm not saying that you need to railroad your players into doing every single one of these scenes in this exact order. They're just scenes that in the 2 times that I've run the scenario, I've noticed have really moved the story forward the most out of everything that the PCs have done. So like I said earlier, this module is a decent sized sandbox and no 2 playthroughs are going to be the same. So there isn't really a quick trick here. You kind of just need to prep the material and know it well so that when your players do things that you're not expecting, you're ready to improvise and adapt. So similar to the investigation section, the way to run the final confrontation with those who wait is really going to depend heavily on what your players' choices are. I would say broadly, players tend to fall into two buckets here. The first bucket is the more heroic PCs who are going to go out in search of a fight with the monster. And then the second bucket is those who are going to hole up in the sanatorium and hope that they can make it until they get rescued. If your PCs are the heroic type and they strike out in search of the monster on the island, your job is pretty easy. Honestly, what I would suggest doing is just whatever idea it is that they have about how to find the monster, have that idea be right. It'll reinforce the feeling that the PCs understand the world, and also it'll drive the action. So most PCs will just go directly to the lighthouse, and I found that running that encounter exactly as written works really great, especially the surprise of opening the second story. The other way that you can kick off the encounter is if the players try to hole up in the sanatorium, you can have the monster come to them. First, send Charles Johnson, the orderly, to grab somebody for sacrifice, and if the players kill him, then the monster can come itself the next night and try to grab people through the windows. Use a steep sanity penalty if the players let the monster feed without interfering, because it's pretty horrific to think, like, I just let somebody die to that fate. Depending on what the players know about the monster's weaknesses and whether they have an Elder Sign or not, you might want to drop some environmental hints about the monster's weaknesses, just so that the players at least have a fighting chance. For example, maybe it twitches at a lightning bolt that happens during a storm, or maybe one of the investigators is carrying a flaming torch and they notice that it kind of recoils when the torches move towards it. Once the fight begins, the best way to keep things interesting is to have the monster liberally use its possession ability against the PCs, because having to fight off a possessed friend while they're trying to execute their plan to drive the creature into the sea adds a great element of tension to the combat, because they want to make sure that their friend doesn't stop them, but they also don't want to kill their friend. So there you go, that's the sanatorium. I promised you a 1-minute plan that you could follow to run the scenario successfully, so let's give it a shot. Dr. Brewer's controversial psychological research has enabled a mythos monster to gate into the sanatorium. The monster is compelling an orderly to perform sacrifices for it while it hides in the lighthouse. The creature needs to consume enough humans in order to metamorphosize into a much larger, more dangerous creature, destroying everyone on the island in the process. The scenario is composed of three main parts. Firstly, the approach to the sanatorium. During this section, you want to set the mood and set the duration of time that the investigators will be on the island. And then you want to spring the scenario on them when they find that all the patients are loose and the workers are dead. Secondly is the main investigation. You want your players to get three main clues. Firstly, a monster was unleashed through the gate in Alan Harding's cell. Secondly, an orderly from the sanatorium is performing ritual sacrifices that are likely connected to the monster. And then third and finally, the monster's origin is connected to the ancient Egyptian story in the Castro manuscript and to Darlene's priestess Enefis personality. There's five main role-playing scenes that you want to play out to give the players these clues. Firstly, discovering Ebenezer's murder. Secondly, seeing Dr. Brewer's office and his body sacrificed. Thirdly, discovering the gate and the poet, Alan Harding. Fourthly, confronting Charles Johnson, the orderly. And then fifth and finally, contacting Priestess Enefis through Darlene. Once the players understand the weaknesses of those who wait, they can go confront the monster and kill it using one of the weaknesses, or they can try to wait out their time at the sanatorium, in which case the monster will come to them. If the players don't defeat the monster in time, it metamorphosizes and kills everybody. I hope this video was helpful. I'm doing my best to regularly put out RPG content on this channel, so be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss anything coming down the pipe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.